souls and their families on the day of resurrection. Most certainly, this is the worst loss. Losing the soul is a literal. When we don't pray, we don't worship God alone, the soul shrinks. Not only to zero, it goes to negative. Just be full of negative charges. Losing their souls and their families, because a soul that is shrunk is repulsed by everything else. Do you remember those movies about gambling and the Old West and drinking and shooting and killing? Murders, fighting, shooting and killing are always associated with the places of gambling and drinking. Because the souls are so shrunk, there's so much hate. Yeah, it's amazing how they show those movies and they have poker hands or something, and they focus on the faces, and so, there's so much hatred and cheating and money grabbing,
greed,
and then they shoot each other. They're reaching for their guns, you know, every few minutes.
They have their guns on their lap, actually.
Yes, exactly.
When they play poker, or on the table, and right. Whiskey.
Yes. Yeah. Gambling and drinking.
And the gun, yeah. In France, for instance, they show these films, of all the films they show in 1 week in France. There are so many killings and murders, and it's only this.
Well, that was Murder Week or something?
No,
the movie.
Every week.
Oh, every week.
Yeah, it's nothing but that.
Yeah. It affects the people.
Of course.
16. They will have masses of fire on top of them and under them. God thus alerts his servants, O my servants, you shall reverence me. As for those who discarded the worship of all idols and devoted themselves totally to God, they have the good news. Give good news to my servants. They are the ones who examine all words, then follow the best. These are the ones whom God has guided. These are the ones who possess intelligence. For those who have incurred the retribution, can you save those who are already in hell? As for those who reverence the Lord, they will have mansions upon mansions constructed for them with flowing streams. This is God's promise, and God never breaks his promise. Do you not see that God sends down from the sky water, then places it into underground wells, then produces with it plants of various colors, then they grow until they turn yellow and become hay? This should be a reminder for those who possess intelligence. I think I'll stop here and have general discussions if there's any.
By interruption here, by Mokpan, isn't it devil, Shaitan, is any action here or any? For example, Mokpan, what they call the interruption, make me a little nervous, I don't understand properly.
Say it again, start all over again.
Okay, Mokpan. But the cause, it makes me nervous, my son, Muhammad.
Uh-huh.
So, it interrupts, really, and you make me nervous, I can understand.
Oh, Bill Muhammad is making noise?
Yeah.
That's natural.
Shaitan has any...
Yes.
Power?
Yes. He scares you and makes you nervous. You need to relax. Concentrate on that. Don't worry. He's in God's hand. Yeah. In the Kaddish, you're trying to kill the body.
Does the gym that you were born with, you know, as an early child, can he already start when you're too young to really understand and understand the Quran? Are you starting to influence his views of Satan? Not like take the cookies from the cookie jar, but stuff like there's no God and already starts.
Yes, that would be from Satan. It has to do with God. But remember that the jinn is also a baby at the time you're a baby.
Oh.
Yes.
Yeah.
But our qualities as humans are not really complete. They grow, we grow in our human qualities, and so does the jinn. He also grows in his jinn qualities.
So mischievousness in children is when the jinn is in control.
No, I didn't say that. I said the exact opposite. I said that when there are children in the jinn, there are also children.
Yeah.
It's not an adult jinn getting hold of a child.
No, I heard.
The jinn also is a child.
Yeah, but I mean,
it's directly proportionate.
You mean to the age?
Parallel.
Yes. As soon as the human being begins to reason, so will the jinn. And he will, for example, he will tell you, as of now, don't get up early in the morning to do the morning prayer. It's more fun to sleep, he'll tell you. He'll even keep you from school homework. He'll make it boring for you. You know, it's really crazy. Jinn tells us the things that are bad for us. And don't they realize that if I starve, he'll starve too? You know? Because they share in our pain and our joys.
As many
companions as human beings. Every human being is two. A human being and a companion. A human being and a companion.
No,
jinns are the freed companions. There are many more of those.
But Satan must be really stupid, because he wants to prove that he's competent.
Yes.
But basically, he's just proving the opposite all the time. Willingly.
How?
Well, he should be as smart to see that his ways are destructive, that they don't lead anywhere. So why can't he have enough intelligence and draw the conclusions that
because he's still hoping that he can fix everything.
Yeah. Just
he's
like
still hoping, yeah.
Just like the perestroika. He has to continue the perestroika.
Right. Yes. Very good. Very good analogy.
Because I said, just to understand a little bit what he's saying, right now it's just 10% of the population.
The total human population, yes.
So he thinks he still has a lot of time to catch up.
Yes, he's still hoping that he will fix everything. But things keep up and up. Just as he takes care of polio, for example, AIDS comes up. And he's working on AIDS, so it's like somebody who's guarding a wall or a dam that has leaks in it. I always give this analogy, and he puts his finger in the hole to stop the water, but another leak comes up to put the other hole. But it seems like right now he's got all 10 fingers and 10 toes.
He's running out of
fingers. Yes, like out of fingers and toes. This is the purpose of that system of increasing the population. For example, how come AIDS didn't show up 1,000 years ago? There were homosexuals 1,000 years ago. So why didn't AIDS show up then? Can you guess? Why do we have AIDS now and not 1,000 years ago? Where did it come from?
They become so vocal now and so violent about it. They allow us to. They become very open and
they were give Muhammad a chance to think. Could you keep the children apart? Call your child next to you.
Mark on.
Annie, come here. Come here. Sit up, please. Come here. The only way to keep him quiet is to keep him apart. Yes. Hanan, come next to mom. Okay, where do you prefer to sit? In that chair over there? You prefer to sit in that chair? No? Okay, you pick out a good spot. What's the best spot? Where you are? Okay. Okay, Muhammad. That is attention away from that.
Like the during the Romans, the whole empire collapsed mostly because of the wrongdoing. They have other diseases. But the population was small.
Yes.
So very small population. So he gave him just a test of what he tried to make a perfect world with the Romans, for instance, if you take the Roman Empire, that the general idea, just like in the communists, as long as it's on the paper, it's fantastic, it has to stay in the paper. So they try to, they put it on application.
The whole thing
could collapse.
Yeah.
And,
My feeling is that AIDS, okay, when the 1,000 years ago, the population of the earth was very small, and Satan was able to handle that. But now that the population increased, he's losing control. So we get all this, all the starving children in Africa and AIDS. So things are getting out of control for him. And if I get the chance in the next few days, maybe we had examples here of Satan's incompetence, where we have proof that his ability to see is very limited. I mean, God sees everything in the universe. Not a single atom is out of God's control. But we have very strong evidence that Satan's control is very limited, and he cannot. He had very serious limitations with seeing.
By the way, we need to conclude the wrong thing, as the wrong point. Satan wants to, how do you say, prevent poverty, starvation, and all AIDS. Scientists, for example, to try to find a cure for AIDS. Or people, how do you say, charitable people who try to, how do you say, help starving people. Mm-hmm. Do they help Satan to make it better?
He helps them, yes. Satan is trying very hard to make everything perfect.
I know that, for example, if we help starving children, do you help Satan? By the way, we shouldn't help starving people.
No, you help because that's your requirement, but it doesn't make any difference. As far as Satan is concerned.
Something I don't understand. If you try to have a good world, or mm-hmm. have a good, for example, state, whatever, if to be good is Satan object...
Your zakat, your contribution is insignificant. Do not counteract the damage that Satan is doing by his incompetence. Not correct, but it is my duty and your duty to give zakat and to be charitable. And this is in Surah 36. This is what the unbelievers will say. Do you want me to feed somebody that God wants to starve? God wants him to starve. Why should I feed him? This is what he's saying. But that's not.
I think in God's dominion, things will go bad, good, go to good, but.
Things will go back.
Satan
will
want to make it good.
Right. Satan is trying to make it good.
We have to
let me mention it now and very quickly. Anyway, the miracle of Quran, which is a fantastic finding at this time, came out of Satan's pocket. It was hidden in his pocket because. Because this is a long story, I don't have to make it short without doing it injustice. That I was working for Monsanto company, and then I had to give a paper at the American Chemical Society meeting in Chicago, 1970. And after I gave the paper, this gentleman approaches me and he says, he's the research director for Anheuser-Busch, same city where I was working. I was working for Monsanto in St. Louis. Anheuser-Busch is the biggest brewery in the world. Produces more alcohol than any place in the world, drink for drinking, beer. And he came and he said, we'd like you to work for us. So I laughed. I said, no way, I can't work for Anheuser-Busch. He says, why? I said, because I'm a Muslim and I can't deal with alcohol. He said, this position has nothing to do with alcohol. You're going to be in the food technology section, the food research section, and it has nothing to do with alcohol. It has to do with yeast, baker's yeast and brewer's yeast and so on. I said, I will be connected with the name of Anheuser-Busch, and this is something I don't want to be connected with the name of Anheuser-Busch. And he said, then he starts from another angle. He said, what we're trying to do is, in the world, there are millions of tons of yeast and other agricultural waste that we throw away, and it's full of protein. If you can help us get this protein out and turn it into food, those starving people in your country and back in Africa will not be starving. So he's trying to use a humanitarian thing. I mean, he was really persistent. And I was also persistent. There was no way I'd work for Anheuser-Busch. Then he said, how much do you make at Monsanto? I said, 14,000. He said, we'll give you 24,000. I said, what do I sign? I mean, give me a big raise. After all this discussion, convincing and so on. Anyway, I said, why do I care if the people think I was working for Anheuser-Busch? As long as my work is not contributing to the alcohol, has nothing to do with it, and is not against God's law, so I will go. $10,000 more, it's almost doubling the salary. So I went to Anheuser-Busch, and this is where the miracle was discovered, inside the brewery in St. Louis, the biggest brewery in the world. And Satan, of course, would have tried to stop this. But you can imagine him looking at the world and seeing, oh, this is the brewery, or this is my pocket here. I can't do. Nothing godly could be going on in there.
Yes. This came out of it.
Yes, this came out of it. And Ahsan told me, remember when we used to play, our kids in Egypt, the kids play games where you take an object and hide it, and then people go look for it. So the best place to hide is in the pocket of the person who's looking for the object. If you can slide it in their pocket, they'll go around looking and it's in their pocket. Also, the circumstances that worked out, again, very quickly, I mentioned this. Their biggest problem was how to break the yeast wall to get the protein out of it. The yeast wall is very strong. And they tried everything. And the first week I was there, the first week, I decided to use potassium hydroxide. It's called, it's like sodium hydroxide acid, caustics. So I decided to use potassium hydroxide for the first time, and sure enough, protein came out. So it was a process that became patented. It was a breakthrough. And the way you do it is you put the yeast in potassium hydroxide for 4 hours. So what do I do for 4 hours? I do my Quran research and the counting of the letters and so on. This is what I did. So I go. What do you do for 4 hours waiting for the thing to hydrolyze? So I go 8 o'clock in the morning. I put the yeast in the and take the lift for 4 hours and come to my office and do all the calculations and the work. And then in the afternoon I would look at the microscope for maybe start another batch in the afternoon. It takes 4 hours. So this is what we learned from this, Muhammad, is that Satan is very limited in his vision, because Satan, if people are going to study theology, for example, children, you go to a theological school, Satan will possess those kids because he knows they will be leaders who will teach the people religion. He owns them all. from the Pope to the Sheikh of Azhar to all the mullahs of Iran. Because from their youth, he knows these people are going into religion. So, he will not look in breweries for any godly work. The moral of the story is, not an atom is absent from God, but Satan has serious limitations. This was a very serious limitation. If we put ourselves in Satan's shoes, and we see the miracle in process, and he has this ability, he can go and mess it up.
He cannot.
He can.
Oh,
if it's obvious.
He can try.
Yes. Because he possesses, for example, the children, I just mentioned that the children who are going into theology, he owns them because he knows if he gets hold of one religious leader, he can manipulate millions of people through this one person. This is a statement in the Quran. It says so many signs in the heavens and the earth. Signs of God in the heavens and the earth that the disbelievers pass by totally oblivious to it. But the believers can find God's signs everywhere. Like we were talking a minute ago about the nightclub, the gambling, the intoxicants. You can see exactly what God said in the Quran happened there. The people hate each other, they shoot each other. If you read the paper every day, you see that the crimes and the murders and the fights are in the nightclubs. So that's this proves that the word of God is true.
Can we summarize that Satan wants to make happy to help his kingdom,
yes,
but to give harm people in God's kingdom?
If he can,
yes, he tries. Yes. Yes, he tries to give harm to the other side and to help the other side.
Yes, but he cannot help his domain. So, and this is the whole idea: is to prove his incompetence.
Jerry Lewis is doing
yes.
Doing helping the muscular dystrophy.
Yes.
Now, Satan knows already that all of these people can go to heaven.
Who?
It's the children that they are, you know, retarded.
Yes.
Now, but he's still working hard, gathering like $24 million a year, or $3 billion.
Yes.
To help these kids.
Yes.
But actually, it's false. They've already...
No, it's, see, those are his victims.
Victims, right.
Yes. Victims of his incompetence. Sometimes his deliberate action.
And he doesn't want them to go to heaven?
No, he doesn't want them to go to
That's
heaven.
That's why he wants to save them from death.
Yeah.
Because he knows that if they die before
See, he's trying very hard to have a perfect world. But he just cannot do it.
For other people also, to make them that they are good, to show them that they are good, they are trying.
Yeah.
So actually, he's trying his best to save them from the heaven.
From heaven.
The more
people he can keep after 40, the more people he gets in hell. Yeah.
That's how it is. I met the guy now up here, and he told me about the miracle of 19, that there is a man called Yosef Yazi who wrote a book about music, that there are not 12 tones, you know, do re mi fa sol la ti do, there are 19 tones. And there is a guy who has a music shop in Speedway called Dave Glick, who I will go and find out more about it. Maybe I can...
Very interesting.
19.
Well, I'll go back to work and I'll see you inshallah. Yeah, 3:30. There's 2 o'clock there, but we extended this. 3:30 is the next meeting.
Inshallah.
Call me back.
Thank you.
from the revelation for us, the appearance of God and Magog, 17 centuries. A deep place with a valid possibility that maybe 17 days before the end of the world,
yeah,
17
it's
hours.
Yeah, the ending, 17 before the end.
Yeah, 17 something.
Yeah.
So obviously it's not relevant to us. If it is relevant, God will let us know.
The all creation was exactly that 6 days. After that, no creation comes, no end, no instead, nothing.
Well, your son was born what? A year ago? That's a new creation?
No, just something new, for example.
AIDS virus is new. It never existed before.
There's something you can see by you see, for example.
Yeah, God says he creates what you never knew. So he continues to create the TV. The great-grandfather never saw a TV. That's a creation.
Something big, there's a field, for example. Just
but they keep adding conditions.
Talking about the 17th century, most of the numbers that we're getting about 14th century right now, it is 14th century. I call it the numbers that we find.
Seven pairs.
Right.
Yeah.
So if this is again 17, that
goes on with the 17th century. Well, that's why I lean towards that. But we cannot be sure.
We're not sure.
It's not relevant to us. When it is relevant, God will send information somehow and will let the people know. The believers. Believers are in light, in the light, not in the dark.
What you say makes sense to us. It's been 1400 years and there's 300 years, so that will be like 17 together. That's
yeah.
The plan.
See, in those days, the world, if the world goes on like this at this rate, they will be so advanced that the war or invasion or trouble will not last 9 years. But in any case, you are probably the only people in the world who know that Gog and Magog are mentioned in two surahs and the 17 verses to the end. It's a piece of important piece of information. So I'm going to stop right here with Gog and Magog.
Do you think Buddha was a messenger?
Who?
Buddha?
Yes.
What?
Definitely.
I'm under the impression that he was the one who got rid of Gog and Magog.
Yes.
But how do you know?
Because he preached the worship of God alone. That's the main thing. The number one proof for any messenger is that he preaches the worship of God alone. If you look at the fake messengers, they all have something else besides God. Ghulam Ahmad is a strong believer in Hadith. Joseph Smith is hung up on Jesus, and so on.
Is Ghulam Ahmad also
the
end of the
world? Hadith. He makes up Hadith. Everything they do is based on Hadith. Go take a nap, Barbara.
Yes.
Yeah, another name for the jinns is devils. Because they are Satan's descendants.
It's more advanced to be a devil?
No, just another name. Like your companion can be called the devil. But since it became a believer, we don't like to call her devil anymore.
Saying yesterday about the girl when he was in with adversity, you said there was a reason for it.
The admission test. He claimed that he worships God alone, and Satan said he was a liar. So God said, Satan said, that if you read the book of Job, he said, if you take his property, he will blaspheme you. He said, okay, you can take his property, but you cannot touch him. So he went and destroyed his sheep and cattle and land and home. and didn't affect him. So this is how it went. It doesn't happen quite this way now, because this is a whole different era. But it's just as effective. It's a very exacting test. Admission test.
Yes.
There are four kinds of disasters that I can think of. The admission test, blessings in disguise. I go apply for a job and I don't get it. That's because God sees that if I get this job, there'll be lots of problems created for me. Number three is educational disasters. You step out to get a pinch. This will teach you that you did something wrong. And the fourth one is retribution, like in Sodom and Gomorrah, when an individual or a nation or a community are corrupted beyond to the point of no reform. Then they get smashed. These are the four kinds.
In 79 it says, we granted Solomon the correct understanding, though we endowed both of them with wisdom and knowledge. Does that mean that David was not given the correct understanding?
In that particular incident. These two guys came and they said, his sheep went into my alfalfa and ate it up. What do we do? So David made a judgment, and Solomon made a judgment. I think Solomon's judgment was, this is what I read in books and hear in history, Solomon said, you take his sheep and keep them and use their milk and wool and so on until your alfalfa grows back. You give him his sheep. So who lost? The guy lost his sheep until the alfalfa has grown back. Makes sense. God says, I gave the understanding to Solomon. David was a wonderful, wonderful person. He just spent his time singing, loving God. You can see it in the Psalms. The Quran, and God says, I gave the Psalms to David. So who's? It's because David loves God so much, God inspired him to sing the Psalms. I like those beautiful psalms. It's really the words of God, but it's funny, but the Jews think, or the scripture people, teachers and so on, they think of David as the writer of the psalms. Which is true, but he's the writer of the psalms with God's inspiration. And all of them are loving God. Figure that out. It's like the five prayers a day. We seem like we are doing the five prayers, but it really is a gift from God. Because what Abraham says, he prays, Rabbi ja'alni muqim as-salah. Please God, make me one who observes the five prayers. It's a wonderful way of teaching us. So is it David who wrote the Psalms, or is it God? Is it us who are doing the five prayers, or is it God? It's a gift from God. You cannot do the five daily prayers unless God wills that you be guided and you receive that gift and do the five prayers. Why do these kids do the five prayers? Why? Because, of course, we're telling them. We say, Nora, you must pray. You pray five times a day? You know Surah Al-Hamd? Surah Al-Fatiha, read it loud. Yeah, I know. They say, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, say it loud. So Ihsan will hear you. Tell her. Yeah, I know. Don't be shy. Loud, loud. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah. Go ahead.
Chocolate.
Yes.
Chocolate.
Where's my brother? Where's my?
Back home.
Well, I'll get somebody else to read it and give him the chocolate. So you go ahead and give the chocolate to him. She can't hear you.
Of course you can read. God gave it to you. Go ahead. Even during your heart, doing this stuff, go ahead, go ahead.
Can you read it? No? There's more in there.
Good. What
is that?
Good.
Where is the son's mom?
My son's mom? He's, I don't know, in the Phoenix. Phoenix. Medicine? Should I get you medicine? She'll be here by, inshallah, by next couple of hours.
Okay, now we have to deal with this important question. Why did she know how to know Al-Fatiha and five prayers? If it's a gift from God, we are telling them to do the five prayers. Why is Omar? Why is Omar doing the five prayers? Not our kids, because God put them in Roxana's house, so she'll teach him how to do the prayers. This is how God is giving him that gift for the five prayers. Fasting of the month of Ramadan is a gift. You cannot do it unless God gives you that gift.
Inshallah.
Yes. When a baby is born, there's a careful selection process where God chooses a certain soul to assign to that baby. The baby is born in the Karmali house. So God selects a specific soul to be assigned to that baby. Because that baby deserves to be taught how to do the five prayers and be taught to observe them, and so on.
That's why it says that on the last day, those people who did not do righteous works, the hereafter and their family.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it's one of the verses.
Yeah.
Yes. You see, if you look at the statistics, the true believers are worshipping God alone are 1 in 10 million, for example. 1 in 100 million, okay. So how is it that a whole family, in one house you have 3 or 4 people believing? How does this, I mean, this doesn't follow the statistics, but it's because of that. There's also one good proof of this fact is that when God says in the Bible to the children of Israel, if you do not keep the commandments, you will be cursed and your children will be cursed up to 4 generations. So the immediate question that people will ask, what is the fault of the children? They're innocent. In fact, I said this to the Arabs the other day, some Arab. He said, you mean the door of repentance is closed on the Arabs until the end of the world? I said, yes. He said, how would that be, the children, this and that? He said, when a baby is born in your house, God's going to assign an evil soul to your house. That's how. That's why I was testing Muhammad, and I knew him first. I said, this is a nice guy, you know. He couldn't be an Arab. How could that be, you know? Why is he so nice? You know? And then he volunteered the piece of information. It's just in the, my grandmother was Italian. She, God bless you. That's it. Thank you. God answered my questions right away. Huh?
He looks Italian.
Yes. Powerful influence. MashaAllah. But when God says that your children of the disbelievers will be cursed in up to four generations, it means that whatever babies are born in their homes for four generations will be, God will assign evil souls. There's a pool of souls, and God knows exactly who are the good souls and who are the bad souls. They already have the stamp on them, heaven or hell.
So, my mind is saying, if I understand correctly, I hope so. So, someone shouldn't, the old generation shouldn't get married with any Arab and people who live in the Arab country.
Why?
Because
there's
baby,
nothing to do.
Maybe they're born in that area, maybe it's going to be there.
No, but wherever you go, it's, how about these people, your neighbors? In your apartment building, how many people worship God alone?
I see only one.
There you have it, so it doesn't matter where you go. Mm. Yeah. No, don't put restrictions on yourself.
Being
sold
on that contagious.
Right, exactly. Okay, I'll see you inshallah for the Maghrib prayer, 5:30, 1 hour from now.
The 2 years and 8 months.
Rahman Rahim. All the kind of miracles made obsolete. We have a computer aids miracle. Keep the kids away from each other, please. Get your kids and make them next to you. We have to separate the kids from each other. Fergal, come and sit next to Daddy. Maha, Maha. Come and sit here, honey. Come and sit here. And this
bottom.
Come and sit here. Yeah. Gonna. Can sit on it.
Bottom.
All the kind of miracles made obsolete. Gonna put him between you and Eric.
Yeah.
Muhammad. Easy, easy, so he doesn't cry. We defeat the purpose. 59. What stopped us from sending the miracles is that the previous generations have rejected them. For example, we sought Thamud the camel, a profound miracle, but they transgressed against it. We sent the miracles only to instill reverence. The children of Israel saw the Red Sea part and they passed through the water, but they still worshiped the calf later on. So that kind of miracle was made obsolete, and now we have this mental miracle that people must think about. They look at it, they think, they have a long time, anytime, anywhere, and they can see the miracle and witness it. Number 60. We informed you that your Lord fully controls all the people. But we rendered the vision that we showed you, including the tree that is accursed in the Quran, only a test for the people. We showed them miracles, but this only augmented their defiance. So the Prophet Muhammad came back and he said, I went up to the first heaven, I was given the Quran, and this was a test. Some people believed and some did not. When we said to the angels, fall prostrate before Adam, they fell prostrate except Satan. He said, shall I prostrate to one you created from mud? He said, since you have honored him over me, if you respite me till the day of resurrection, I will possess all his descendants, except for a few. He said, go, you and those who follow you will end up in hell as your just retribution. Go ahead and entice them with your voice. Mobilize all your forces and all your men against them. And take a share of their money and children. And promise them. Anything the devil promises is no more than an illusion. So, you can see, Satan is the reality. And in this world, the secular world, it's a very bad thing to believe in Satan, that Satan exists. They try to make you look like a quack or a strange person if you talk about Satan or indicate that you believe in Satan.
No.
Satan certainly is a reality. One of his targets or his objectives is to make the people avoid talking about him. If you believe in God, you believe that Satan exists because God said so. We want to welcome Omnia here without embarrassing her. Welcome to Tusa. He said in 64, God said to Satan, go ahead and entice them with your voice. Mobilize all your forces and all your men against them. And take a share of their money and children and promise them. Anything the devil promises is no more than an illusion. 65, as for my servants, you have no power over them. Muhammad. You have to stop talking, Muhammad. Hey, you too. Okay. 66. Your Lord is the one who causes the ships to float on the ocean, that you may seek His bounties. He is most merciful towards you. Bad weather, friends. This is playing on an American idiom. Bad weather, friends, if you are afflicted in the middle of the sea, you forget your idols and sincerely implore Him. But as soon as He saves you to the shore, you revert.